the Sounding Board. This is a weekly community television program produced by club members of Soroptimist International of Novato. The mission of the organization is to help improve the lives of women and girls. We do this a lot by education and knowledge. And with that in mind, we're doing a series of six museums right here in the community of Novato. I have with me Jim Crumpler, who's a recently retired pharmacist from CVS. He's taken it as his personal mission to pull together the six diversely funded museums in the community and form an association, a museum association, so that they can share common resources. So, Jim, you've been the one to pretty much pull all these six programs together, but you know, they might not know what all six museums are, so let's go over it.
So the Novato Museum Association is made up of this one. This is probably the furthest south, just about. This is Novato Hamilton Field History Museum.
Hamilton Field Museum, and that's where we're going today.
So that's the one we're standing in front of. About two blocks away from here is the other southernmost museum, and that's Marin Mocha, Museum of Contemporary Art. Then going farther north, you come to Ignacio, and that's a space station museum.
That's three.
Then you go up to Novato, and you turn on DeLong, and on DeLong, you come to the Novato History Museum. Then you continue down Novato Boulevard, and you come to the Museum of American Indian. You get back on 101 and the frontage road, actually, and go up to Olin Pauley State Park, where there is a museum there.
Excellent.
Six really small museums, but they're close together. You can see almost all of them in a day. They all have something pretty interesting to see.
So today we're going to go into the Novato Hamilton Field Museum. And you know, I'm looking at this building. It doesn't look really like it was designed to be a museum. So I think there's a little history there. Tell us about it.
Well, originally it was designed to be with these big doors. Mm. It was designed to be a combination firehouse and police station. So the farthest door over there had an ambulance. That's where the ambulance were. These two big doors and probably this one were more, that door over there was more like the crash cart with the plane crash. There was a special vehicle in there that would go out there. And then these were, the other two were basically for the fire engines. And they shared this building with the police officers, you know, police part, I guess, whatever it was. And this, you know, this was back in the early 30s. When aviation wasn't that big of a deal, because there wasn't an Air Force. You know, the Air Force didn't come into existence until 1947. You know, and originally, you know, like I said, airplanes weren't that big of a deal. They planned on putting lawns out here for the planes to land on.
Lawns?
Lawns. That's what they landed on in the 30s.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Well, this is exciting. Are we ready to go inside?
We are.
Yeah, it's cold out here. Let's go. Well, here's Ray Dwelly. How are you, Ray?
Good to see you.
Ray is the Director of Operations and Maintenance for the museum. So, and we know that you're kind of in charge of this welcoming area here. So tell us, what are people going to see when they come in here, Ray?
When I first come in, they see a plaque and stuff of the fellow that designed the base.
Howard Nurse?
Howard Nurse.
I've heard his name.
Then there's a DVD of they can watch of the whole history of the vase. We have a display of Lloyd Hamilton, who the base was named after. He was a World War I pilot that was shot down by ground fire.
Oh, dear.
You got to remember the planes back then didn't fly very high.
Yeah.
And we have a diorama that was built by Disney. Of the Hangar 7.
Diorama, what's a diorama? Explain.
A diorama is a model.
A model, okay.
Of a particular item. We have pictures around the wall of the base in several stages of being built on it.
There's so much here.
Got a display of flying tigers. They had some connection to us because two squadrons of bombers left from here to go with the Flying Tigers. Most people don't know that bombers were with the Flying Tigers on it. another right in the center here is another diorama of the base in 1939.
This is really clever.
It kind of looks a little scattered. When the war started, a whole bunch of buildings were built in all those vacant areas there.
And
we're in the firehouse, which is right there.
Right there. Now, I noticed these all have, they're all painted sort of a tile color, which makes me think of the community or the original designs by Captain Nurse. So tell us a little bit about that concept that he had.
They were all in the Spanish motif. They were all in tile roofs.
Way back then, he had the vision to make this place so beautiful.
A lot of these buildings are still here now. The hospital building, we get all kinds of people in here that were born in the hospital.
Really?
Because they're that age group now. And so they come back here to see it.
That's the swimming pool and this little
No, that's the amphitheater there.
Oh, amphitheater's still
there. Actually, the swimming pool was over in here.
Oh.
These buildings are still here. They're senior housing now. That one's gone, and that one's gone. The hangars are here. They've all been converted into office buildings. They're really nice.
Are some of the big names that are in those buildings now?
The Marin Foundation, I guess, is one of the biggest ones.
Uh-huh. And U.S. Coast Guard.
And the U.S. Coast Guard has hangars 1 and 2. There is no air operations out of here.
Okay.
The only thing that land here now are ducks and geese. The whole runway area here has been flooded and turned into wetlands.
Right, right. And there's a beautiful path along there, a walking path, isn't there?
Yes, there's a walking path that runs all along the back of the area right here, the whole length of it.
Well, there's so much in here, Ray. It's impossible to cover right now, and we hope that this is what's going to excite people to come in and see more. Are there any highlights around here that we still need to talk about?
The Hap Arnold, who was very instrumental in the development of base, the Air Force. He was the only 5-star general in both the Army Air Corps and the Army Air Force. Originally, this was an Army base. It was the Army Air Corps. The Air Force itself did not come into existence until 1947.
Got it.
So it was our Army before that. Well, Hap Arnold lived up in Sonoma, and Arnold Drive is named after him
really?
Now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, you know, it's got a lot of history here.
Well, I know there's a lot more than just here.
Well, we've got a whole downstairs area where they used to keep the fire engines and everything.
Really? Downstairs? Okay.
Yeah, this was turned into an office building in 1958, because they had
before it became a museum then.
Yeah, yeah. It was the firehouse had to move because of structural problems with the floor. And then it was turned into an office building, and then we got it in 2002.
Shall we go downstairs?
2020. Sure.
Okay. Lead the way. Well, here's John Trumbull. Hi, John.
Greetings. Welcome to the museum.
Thank you for being here. I understand you've been a real active docent all along here with the museum and done some marvelous things and have a lot of knowledge. So here we are in this room of just fabulous treasures, and I see all these model planes behind me. So tell us about them.
Oh, happily. This is... This is the model of the B-10, B-10B bomber, that's for whom the base was built. But then when the Golden Gate Bridge got put up and in the 30s, the active idea that maybe we were going to be invaded by Japan, the bombers were moved out of here and the fighters were moved from Crissy Field up here. These models that we have all along this wall were built by Ewry, a volunteer out of Mill Valley who's done an excellent job of constructing and painting and researching. So the planes are in the colors they would have been at if you showed up here at Hamilton and looked at them in real life.
And they're all in order of the chronological.
We start out with the P-26 pea shooter, which is the first all-metal fighter plane in the United States Armory, and we go all the way down, all the way down to the F-106. These are not all the planes that flew out of Hamilton, but all these planes flew out of Hamilton.
Right, got it.
And they're all in the same scale. They're all 1 inch on the model equals 4 feet in real life. And there are little people that are set up here along the along next to some of the exhibits, about every other plane or so. And those people are scaled to about your size, probably, okay, about 5 feet. So yeah, you can see how the planes have developed in terms of design and power and size and speed. It's just been, the 40 years that Hamilton was open were just a marvelous period of development in aircraft. It was starting out very rapidly in the 30s with air races and dirigibles. Did you know, by the way, that we almost had a dirigible base here at Hamilton for international service from Tokyo to San Francisco?
Wow.
There was a Japanese consortium that actually proposed that when Hamilton was being considered. And you can tell that the dirigibles were important in development, because Moffett was built about the same time that Hamilton was built, and it was built for dirigibles. So we were originally going to be a bomber base for the B-10, but then the B-17 came along, and it was too big and too heavy to fly out of Hamilton on the runway loaded. It could land here, and but it was too heavy to be stationed here, so
wow,
they moved it out. Now, during World War II, it came back, and we had B-17s flying out of here to Hawaii, but they were flying out stripped. They took all the guns off of it. They took everything out of it that wasn't necessary to ferry the aircraft over, which is the reason that the B-17s arriving on December 7th of 1941 were helpless. They were out of gas. They had no armament. There was nothing they could do to evade the Japanese, so they just had to land at Captain Nurse's other base.
Oh, my.
Because he went from here and designed Hickam Field and built it.
Interesting.
So this development of the aircraft is all laid out along here, and it's really fascinating.
It really is.
To talk about. You can spend a lot of time looking at these models. You already did a good job.
Excellent. Well, let's continue on around the building, because I know in the back corner is one of Jim Crumpler's favorite things, and that is where all the wrecks have been taking place in Marin County.
Yes.
Let's go look at it.
That's some help with that one.
So, John, this is the corner that has all the information and all the bits and pieces of the crashes, and there's Jim Crumpler's favorite thing on the wall over there. Let's look at it closely. But this is all the crashes that have happened in Marin County. Is that right?
Yes. There's a ranger for the Marin County Water District that patrols their open space area, you know, the hills and around here and all of that. And he has made a hobby of collecting parts and pieces of various aircraft and researching the crashes. And this is a map that designates, it shows the designation of the of the planes that have gone down in Marin County, all the way from the old Impala crashes out here, a lot around San Rafael, and up here in the mountain areas.
I understand there's one up in Mount Tam that even some of the rangers will point out that's still there as a big piece. Is that right?
I think the one you're talking about is that there's an engine from a B-17 that still exists on the Scout Trail, but I think that's over, not on, I think it's on Mount
Bridell?
Yeah, Mount Tamalpais, not
Mount
on Mount
Tam.
Bridell.
Okay,
I think it's on
Mount
the backside.
Tam. Oh, okay.
You know, there were, I think, two or three fighter planes that went in on Red Hill and down in San Rafael. And these are parts that have been scattered around in the area that he's been recovering over a period of time.
Some big pieces.
And some of it is fairly large. It's this is a section of a landing gear out of a B-24 that landed almost across the freeway from us here in Novato.
Uh-huh.
And then parts of a propeller. So this is one of the reasons that Hamilton was closed, was because the residents of Belle Marin Keys got really nervous about the fact that planes were taking off over their houses.
I can understand why.
I'm a little surprised that they didn't realize there was an air base here, which preceded their housing development by about 25 or 30 years.
True. Oh, look at, on that wall, I see all kinds of photographs of women. What's going on there? There's a whole bank of photographs of women.
Well, there's a, You know, it's always interesting to look at subgroups that have been here at Hamilton, and the WAF, the Women's Air Force, WASP, Women's Air Service Pilots. One of them is on our DVD talking about women flying planes in and out of Hamilton.
Interesting.
The nurses from the Bataan Death March, when they were liberated, first set foot in the United States here at Hamilton, and we have a picture of them coming off their planes. But we've had a pretty good history of women activities here at Hamilton.
Well, let's move on down here and see what we've got here. We've got a lot of uniforms in action here.
Yes, these are mostly World War II uniforms, and they show the various stages of social development or of social activity for women. This is a Class A uniform, so to speak. This is a formal uniform for a master sergeant.
Interesting. So that would be evening wear.
Yeah, the two ladies who wore these uniforms actually were here as docents. This is a Red Cross uniform, which is rather interesting, and that's a nurse's uniform. I think that's a nurse's uniform here. That's a nurse's uniform here on the far end. Mm-hmm. They obviously weren't as glamorous as the other ladies. This group of uniforms from here to here are actually part of an exhibit that was constructed fairly recently by the daughter of the commander of the Coast Guard, who were stationed here at Hamilton. This is a Coast Guard exhibit.
That's an existing uniform right now.
Yeah,
huh?
This is what's happening here at Hamilton right now in Hangars 1 and 2.
And that? What's that?
It's a hazmat team.
Oh, of course.
So this is their cleanup uniform.
Oh my gosh. Okay, good. And then we have.
And then we have the men. And this would be a modern working uniform. This was what would have gone up in the B-17, and it's interesting that to talk to people about, you know, what it was like when you didn't have any atmosphere inside your aircraft. You're at 30,000 feet, there's no oxygen. You're going to get your oxygen through a tube, but there are people shooting at your airplane. What happens then? Well, there's a little bottle right down here that gives you just enough chance to try and get the old airplane down before you either freeze to death or suffocate.
Oh, it's interesting. They don't really look that much different, do they? From the old days and the new day and today.
This is the Class A uniform, like the Class A uniform for the ladies. And this is the formal uniform, like the formal uniform for the ladies.
Excellent. Okay, well, what do I see over your shoulder? I see
that's our,
that, the training.
Yes, that's our joyride.
Okay,
so
let's go look at it. This is where they trained on how to fly an airplane? They got in here?
Okay, well, remember Hamilton was built in the 1930s.
Uh-huh.
And back in the 1930s, prior to 1930, airplanes were made basically out of wood and canvas and dope and all that sort of stuff. And they were open cockpit. So how did you find out where you were? Well, you had Rand McNally's road map strapped on your leg, and you flew along and you tilted your aircraft and looked out, and you looked for a river, a road, a town. They had made 26 foot long cement arrows to tell people where they were and how they should
be
flying.
Oh my gosh.
But that doesn't work at night, and it doesn't work in rain. So when they put a top on the cockpit, and they had people like in the late 30s, the Air Force here at Hamilton was tasked to deliver airmail. Civilian airmail, and so they're flying up and down the entire coast through the mountain ranges, and they had to fly at night and in bad weather. We were killing people doing that.
Yeah,
it was really tough. So Edwin Link, who was a maker of organs and Nickelodeons and was familiar with pumps and wiring and all of that, worked out this machine, which has a full-scale cockpit in it. You put the pilot in it, put the top down over him. He couldn't see what was going on. Then you told him that he had to fly a certain distance at a certain altitude for a certain time and then do a certain maneuver at the end of it. And over here was this orange-colored desk.
Aha, back in
there. There's a scribe that's over a map. So the the operator of the Link trainer can see where the pilot was flying. And the guy sat in here, and this is how he learned to fly in bad weather without being able to see where he was going.
Interesting.
Now remember, we didn't have radar in those days. We had tubes in all of our in our radios and things like that. And remember, with a vacuum tube, if you break the filament, the whole thing's dead.
Oh yeah.
We didn't have GPS, so they didn't know where they were in the world. In fact, even in this machine, you can tell exactly what your plane is doing, but you can't tell where it's doing it. So it is highly possible to fly a perfect pattern in here and end up in the side of a mountain.
Yeah.
If the wind is too much for some reason or another.
Wow.
Anybody that's really interested in why this machine came about and the reasons for it should pick up some of the books relating Dupree World War One flying, and I'm reading an interesting one now, the Airman Who Wouldn't Die, about dirigible. It's a true story about dirigible construction and development in England about the time of the Graf Zeppelin, and it gives you a feeling as to what the airmen were facing. And without computers and without transistors and without all of the guides that we have now, you had to be somewhat crazy, I think, to get up in one of those early planes.
Really?
But our people did it, and here we are, well, decades later.
Speaking of doing research and speaking of those books that you read, do you think there are any down there in the archives room?
I think that Jim might possibly be able to show you just a little bit about the development of aircraft if you go down there, yes.
Excellent. Let's go on down to the archives room. Well, here's the archivist. Hi, Jim. How are you?
Hi, Tara.
Jim Davenport, the official archivist for the museum. Good, good. So, give us a tour. Show us what's on hand here.
Okay, well, as you can see, this is the library, and here we have library materials, mostly books, of course.
Now, when you say library, does that mean those are things people can check out?
Yes, that is true. Anyone can come in and pull things off the shelves, look at them here on the table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. What?
Yes, we also have encyclopedia, reference books, periodicals, magazines. We have a monthly periodical collection here. We have videotapes.
Are there any that are particular hot items that people are...
Well, actually, this section here seems to be the most popular. Because you have a combination of military aviation, Air Force, but also it's general World War II history, seems to be the most the thing most people are interested in when they come here.
Good. Okay.
Yeah. So moving down the line here, we've got more reference books. We've also got more videotapes, coffee table books.
With lots of nice pictures.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Big, colorful photos. Mm-hmm. Lots more of the videotape collection here.
So are these movies or...?
No, they're mostly documentaries.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That have been produced.
And you can check these out as well?
Yes, they can be checked out.
Really? Mm-hmm. Great. I might take a couple home tonight.
There you go.
Good. I like that.
Yeah, and we have more magazines. We've got the main military events through history. That was World War II down there, and this is Korea and then on up to Vietnam. Uh-huh. A little bit of the Iraq period.
Okay.
So it kind of moves down chronologically. Here in the corner we have official U.S. government-issued technical manuals on a variety of
My mother
topics.
Used to have some of these.
Oh, really? Yeah, they're in pretty amazing condition considering how old they are. They're about 70, 80 years old.
Really?
The oldest one's going back to the mid-30s.
Really? Yeah. Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have some black... Serious cabinets.
Yes,
over here.
This is the brain center, if you will, of the Hamilton Field collection, history of museum collection. This is where we keep all of our historic photos. We have some ephemera, flyers, booklets, so forth. A collection of the base guides that came out each year when Hamilton was an active Air Force base. We've also got historical records. collection of maps.
Now, I would assume these valuable things are not to be checked out.
Well, they can be viewed with the assistance of one of the personnel. Usually it's me, the archivist. Okay. It's usually by appointment. So I can kind of get things ready, ask some questions, you know, what is the direction of the research, what exactly are people coming here to look for.
So if I were to pull out a folder here, what could I expect to find?
Well, this is something right here. This is the photo file for the firehouse.
May I touch these?
Oh, yes.
Really,
sleeves. So that's one that was out there in the museum, but there's some others. They're mostly from the 1940s, World War II era.
Ah.
Yeah, this was the firehouse and the Hamilton Field Fire Department.
Oh, and this is the building we're standing in
now. That's it, much later on, just before they were about to open it up as a museum, after it was renovated.
Oh, and here they come down the pole. Yay!
Going down the pole. Uh-huh.
Yeah. I came down one of those poles one time. I loved it. It was so much fun.
Yeah, we were really glad to get that because it really shows. I mean, this is the door to the library right here.
Interesting.
And this was taken, I believe, this was during World War II.
Interesting, mm-hmm. Interesting. Good. Well, you've got some posters here, too. Air show,
yeah.
And wings. Tell us about that.
Yeah, well, that's another aspect of the history of Hamilton Field that many, many people are interested in is... they come in and they spot the air show posters and they immediately start recollecting how they used to go to the air shows. They were tied in when the base was an active Air Force base. They were tied in with the open houses. So every year, it's an annual event. They have an open house and there was an air show that went along with it. And the
Thunderbirds were here then, huh?
It was the Air Force Thunderbirds. That was the Air Force aerial demonstration team. Many people come who grew up on the base and they remember these air shows from when they were kids.
Uh-huh.
So that's always really interesting to hear them recount childhood memories.
Right.
Yeah, and then later on, after the base closed, after the Air Force left, there was still military presence here. But in the late 80s, they had a series of air shows called the Wings of Victory.
Mm.
And it was from 1987 to 1990. And it was, your standard air show with classic aircraft. And
mm-hmm.
We have a videotape of one of them that we show on the wall out there in the museum. And that's another one that many people recall going to, native people that have lived here most of their lives. They all remember the Wings of Victory air shows.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Fun.
So the air shows are definitely a very popular aspect of Hamilton Field.
Right. You know, I hate to point this out, right?
Mm-hmm.
Interrupt any of your thought flow, but there's some interesting photographs
mm-hmm.
up there.
Yeah.
Appears to be some Asians who are maybe refugees?
That's exactly what these are. These are photos taken in the early 80s, 1980 to 83, of the Hamilton Refugee Transit Center. And what that was it was the first stop for entry, the first stop point of entry
uh-huh.
into the U.S. for Vietnamese refugees.
So they all came here?
A great deal of
wow.
them, yes. Many of them came here. At least 175,000 of them spent at least one night.
Oh, my gosh.
Here and it was still called Hamilton Air Force Base.
What a tragic,
yeah.
What a traumatic, I should say traumatic, not tragic, but traumatic
yeah, then,
moment for them to come to the United States and get away from all that horrible stuff that was going
mm-hmm.
on.
Yeah, it was like a rest stop for them because, you know, their flight was, you know, several hours coming in from Southeast Asia.
Oh, yeah.
And here where they had a chance to rest, just kind of get their bearings and acclimate themselves a little bit to American life. And then they went on to other parts of the country where they had sponsors. But they stayed in, we had three former Air Force barracks over off of Hamilton Parkway that they stayed in. They've been torn down now.
Uh-huh.
But these are significant photos, not just for the Vietnamese refugee aspect, but also the great shots of what Hamilton looked like in the early
80s.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you for sharing the archives with
You're
us,
welcome.
Jim. I think the other Jim Crumpler, is probably waiting for me right now.
Okay.
Okay. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Well, Jim, what do you think? Have we got enough information today to get everybody excited about coming over here? Let's What are your favorites here at the museum?
I've got about three things that I never miss when I come here. I always like to see them again. The first thing is the movie. When you walk in, right to the left of the door when you walk in, there's a great movie on the history of Hamilton. It shows the B-17s on their way to Hawaii on actually Pearl Harbor Day. And, you know, they picked the wrong day to go there. Of course, the models, these models are just incredible. You know, scale models of every plane that ever was stationed here. And over there in the corner, there's this little picture of all the crashes that occurred in Marin County, which I think is just amazing.
Scary, actually. Very, very scary. Well, what about that pole?
Well, you know, when this was a firehouse and the guys were sleeping upstairs, the fire pole is still there, and they could get on those trucks really quick.
And they slid down the poles. They really slid down. Oh, my gosh, a real fire pole right there in the middle of it.
The pole is still here.
Great, great. Well, there's lots of exciting history here.
It certainly is.
And the Novato Museum Association does have a website that pulls all six of the museums together, and that is www.novatomuseums.org. So at this time, I would like to give thanks to everybody who contributed today. Jim Crumpler, thank you again, over again. Ray Dwelly, John Trumbull, and Jim Davenport were our very special guests today here at the Novato Field Museum. Marcus Oaken and Nick Logan, who are the filming crew from the Novato Community Television, along with their boss, their manager, Pam Hesley. Thank you for being here. But, you know, most of all, I want to thank you, our viewing audience. Thanks for being here.